the points that Khalid raised about how people arrive in other countries and some seek asylum, but other people who maybe could be a refugee don't seek asylum because they have their own means or they have a job offer. So it's often very kind of confused and mixed, and this is what we are seeing with the Iraqis in the neighboring countries. They were in Syria, in Jordan, they've been there for years or months, and yes, they're very proud people. They hadn't approached agencies such as UNHCR, so they hadn't said, hey, I'm here, I'm a refugee. And now because of the way the situation is continuing, people are running out of savings. We had a survey in July that said that a third of the people we interviewed in Damascus only had savings for a month, and that was in July, several months ago.
Yes.
80% were dependent on fixed-term savings, had no employment. So because of the dire needs and the protracted situation, people are becoming more and more desperate. We hear that about 2,000 people every day inside Iraq are still leaving their homes. Back in the summer, there was about 30,000 people every month arriving inside Syria. Syria has now, in some part, reacted to that and the burden it's facing and has closed its borders, so smaller numbers, only a few people now can come in. So it is, it's a burgeoning problem in Iraq, and it's one that hasn't stopped yet because we are still seeing displacement.
Well, I'd like to come back to the points that were made in the film we saw at the beginning of the program by the head of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, and that's this question of the responsibilities of countries like Britain and America. I mean, it was an Anglo-American idea to invade Iraq, and it could be well argued that it's as a result of that invasion of 2003 that this whole refugee problem has emerged, as she said. And yet the quotas I've seen that the Americans are taking in something like 7,000 Iraqis, and the British, I think the figure is pretty small as well.
A few hundred.
I mean, this is extraordinary, isn't it? I mean, surely we should be making a bigger gesture than this. What about the Iraqis who've worked for the British authorities there and the army and who are in danger themselves because they'll be seen by the insurgents as collaborators and traitors and enemies of the Iraqi people?
Well, we got some Iraqi cases in this country who work in interpreter with some NGOs organization or even with the Americans army. They refuse. We got the Iraqi asylum seeker living in Birmingham or some other city. They refuse. I mean, it should be the USA and the UK. They are responsible for the situation in Iraq. They should be taking more Iraqi asylum seekers, especially now after the failure of Americans' policy in Iraq. The UNHCR, they got more ruling in Iraq, and also they was holding on 16 and 17 of April the conference in Geneva regarding the situations for the Iraqi asylum seeker in neighboring country. So we are asking also the UNHCR to also put a pressure for the UK's government and some other European countries.
We have Claire to from support the UNHCR. Claire, are you putting pressure on the Americans and the British in your diplomatic way to I mean, do you think they really should make a bigger effort?
Well, our position is quite clear. When if people are seeking asylum and they come from central and southern Iraq, in our opinion, they should be considered as refugees. So that's kind of a blanket, prima facie, refugee status from anyone from central and southern Iraq.
Right.
If they don't meet the strict criteria that countries may have as a refugee, we say they should be given humanitarian protection. They should be given some kind of means and status so they can stay in the country. Northern Iraq, slightly different, but our High Commissioner has said recently that, for example, with the threat
Claire, I've got to interrupt you all, and I've got to thank you all my guests, for being here with me. Sorry we've had to cut it short. Khalid Al-Mudallah in Gaza, thank you as well. Claire Graham of the UN High Commission for Refugees, Joanna Perkis of London Citizens, and Dashti Jamal of the Iraqi Refugee Federation, thank you very much. I'm Tim Llewellyn. This is Press TV. And if the viewers have any comments about this edition of Middle East Today or any of our previous editions, please email us at met@presstv.co.uk. Once again, it's met@presstv.co.uk. Thanks for joining us, and see you again next week.
this boy, this very boy, grew up and burned 100,000 Japanese in one single night.
These are the mountainous central highlands of Afghanistan, the Hazara Jat, or the land of the Hazara. And just like these imposing landscapes, the history of the Hazara people is shrouded in mystery.
Headlines this hour. Turkey's army chief says troops are ready for an incursion into northern Iraq as soon as the Turkish government gives the go-ahead. Pakistan's Attorney General says the government will lift state of emergency within 1 month as former Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto is released from house arrest. And UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon opposes the deployment of UN peacekeepers in Somalia.
Hello and welcome to News on Press TV. I'm Turiya Ghaffari.
And I'm Hassan Tabakoli. Thanks for joining us. Turkey's Army Chiefs of Staff says troops are ready for a cross-border operation as soon as the Turkish government gives the go-ahead. General Yasser Buyukhanet says the government and military officials have recently discussed how a military operation should be organized to crowd down Kurdish rebels in northern Iraq. Meanwhile, the Kurdistan Workers' Party, better known as the PKK, said it is open to dialogue based on a political project to start an arms-free process. Turkey has stationed around 100,000 troops on the Iraqi border, threatening to launch an offensive against some 3,000 rebels there. Well, earlier we asked political analyst Attila Yesilada in Istanbul about Turkey's fresh threats against the PKK rebels in northern Iraq.
The threat is much more serious. The key words in General Buchanan's statement that differed from 2 weeks ago is that, as you said, the army has made a formal application to the government to enter Iraq. 2 weeks ago, he had said that the army has not made such an application. The Turkish army rarely bluffs, and this is such a publicly sensitive issue that I wouldn't think they would bluff. There is also further evidence from PKK sources, which has been complaining that American reconnaissance flights have been collecting information on their camps in Kandil Mountains. Even though one cannot, time the timing of a military operation or its scope, I think that the odds of a military operation have increased substantially after yesterday's statements. If the government gives the go-ahead to the army, we will not know it, because the key element in the success of such an operation would be obviously surprised. Yeah, if that ends the story, the global community would breathe a sigh of relief.